Yes.
So you are welcome once again. So today we'll be looking at diagnostic test. Under the diagnostic test, we'll be looking at reference intervals. How do we set reference intervals? And how do we determine the criterion validity of diagnostic tests? Many diagnostic test results are given in form of a continuous variable, such as fasting blood glucose, hemoglobin level, systolic or diastolic blood pressure. But we still have some that are in form of categorical. Like for example, now pap smear, is either is there or not, is not quantified, but there are some that are in form of continuous variable in which you have to have cutoff. But for the one that are categorical, is either positive or negative, or even the positive may have grade. Like the pap smear, you may have grade in the result. Now, for some of those tests that are positive, they are, what I mean by positive diagnostic result is when as the value of the test increases, then the likelihood of having the disease is there. For example, now, hypertension is blood pressure above certain level. Diabetic is blood sugar above certain level. But there are some that are in the opposite direction, like hemoglobin concentration or PCV. It is hemoglobin concentration below certain level that is anemia, or PCV below certain level. So they have different direction. All those things are taken into consideration in determining criteria validity of this test. Then we also look how best to shoot cutoff. And that's in the situation when you have tests that are in form of continuous variable. At what level you see the person has have the attribute? Looking at that. So we start with reference interval. Reference interval is otherwise known as reference range or normal range. The concept was introduced by Gasbeck and Salis in 1969. It was the concept of reference interval. It was in response to growing awareness expressed with great clarity in a reflective paper from Snyder that the concept of normal range had then conceived was flawed. Even today, reference range, reference interval, normal range mean the same thing, but then there was something they call normal range. People now came with reference interval, saying that the concept of normal range was flawed. The current practice at the time was to compare patient results with an ill-defined or at least inconsistently defined range of value called normal range. What they were doing by that time was to just get the blood of a test for medical students who they believe are normal, or health workers, nurses, or every other health workers in the vicinity of the hospital. But you agree with me that health workers, medical students, they are not representative of the people in the population. Because we know that disease occurring has to do with the social status. The poor are more likely to live life that make them to be poor, to be successful, susceptible to disease. So in so doing, you discover that the poor are more likely to be sick than the rich. So you now see that most health workers can be classified as middle class people, while most patients will be lower class people. So apart from that, you know that demographically, the health workers cannot represent the whole population. So taking sample from health workers, people apparently were health workers and now use them as to represent the normal range, now calculate the range to represent the normally in the population is flawed. And that was why some people now came up with this concept of reference interval. But as it today, if people say reference interval, reference range, and normal range, they mean the same thing. But the way they were the concept of the normal range then was what those people argue again that was flawed. Normal range was derived from all and Hill defined population of supposedly normal, meaning healthy individuals. I think I've explained that. Hill defined in the sense that those population they define it from are not representative of the total population. So how do we determine the reference interval or reference range or normal range as we know it today? The National Committee for Clinical Laboratory Standard, now called Clinical and Laboratory Standard Institute, has defined a scheme for determination of reference interval, which is as follows. Reference interval comprises a reference population from which is selected, a reference sample group on which are determined reference value, on which is observed a reference distribution from which are calculated reference limit that we define. Well, it looks somehow, but the same description that is broken down in a flow chart like this. Reference individual. First of all, reference individual, they took sample from reference individual, comprise a reference population from which is selected reference sample group. So what really happened is that, you have a population, you think population in the community, you can select individual, sample individual, or apparently where people in the population, sample individual, then get the values, and now define a range, which you call reference. And when you define the range, it will give you the limit, the range, the range we have lower and upper limit. The lower limit would be then we have the upper limit. So the difference between them is the reference interval. We explain what this upper and lower limit means and how do they get the lower and upper limit. The International Federation of Clinical Chemistry and Laboratory Medicine, IFCC, definition of time. There are some time, all these reference individual. So reference individual is an individual selected for comparison using defined criteria while the defined reference population as all possible reference individual. Usually has an unknown number and is therefore a hypothetical entity. Then reference sample is an adequate number of reference individual taken to represent the reference population. Ideally, it should be randomly drawn from the reference population. What it says is that the sample group now is from the reference population. You use a probability sampling method to ensure that these individuals are representative of the whole population. A reference value is a value test result obtained by observation or measurement of a particular quantity on an individual belonging to a reference sample group. So if it is blood, if it's urine, you take the sample is the reference value, the result you get from it. It may be measurement like a blood pressure. That one that you're not taking sample of blood or whatever. You just do some measurement. It may be anthropometrics you measure. So either you take a sample, you get the result, or you take a measurement. So the reference distribution now is the statistical distribution of the reference value. So when you now gather all of them together, the pattern of occurrence of the value is the reference distribution. Now, we have reference limit. When you set your interval, it just means that the limit, lower and upper limit you feel should be the normal range for the population, and the interval will be the difference between the upper and the lower limit. So of that value, patient test result, the value of the particular type of quantity obtained by either observation or measurement. So what you actually observe is the observed value. So let's leave those lengthy description or definition. Now, how do you estimate reference interval? So there are two methods. Even though there is a third method which you follow an algorithm prescribed by some people, this clinical and laboratory standard institute. But the globally the two methods, normal distribution method, non-parametric percentile method. So two methods. What we mean is that if, how do you know blood sugar that when you do the result and you do your test, how do you know that, okay, this is the normal range where it's supposed to be? No, they often give you in the laboratory and say, oh, this is your result and this is the normal range. It's supposed to be in between these. How do you determine that? Normally, it doesn't really mean that if you just go to the population and take sample, somebody that is apparently where you the person is outside, it doesn't mean the person is sick or it's not normal. Because the normal, the reference value is just the middle value. People just feel okay. Most people in the population we have. It doesn't mean that anybody that have extreme value is not okay. But if somebody comes to the hospital and maybe somebody is sick, is being managed, if you do the test. So if anybody has a value outside that range, it may be a pointer that the person has a problem in that area. But in the population, if the person doesn't have any complaint, the person may be okay. Now, there are two methods, the normal distribution and method and the non-parametric percentile method. The International Federation of Clinical Chemistry and Laboratory Medicine recommended method for estimating reference interval is the non-parametric percentile method. So you see, what is he recommends that it involves simply excluding the lowest 20.5%. So what it means that when you arrange, what do you mean by percentile method is that you arrange the result, if you have sample of 209, just arrange the result from lowest to the highest. The first, you exclude the first 2.5%, we mean that it's extremely low. The highest, the last 2.5% is extremely low. So when you add the first 2.5% and the highest 2.5%, it gives you 5%. So the middle from 2.5 to 97.5, that would be the mean middle 95%. It is believed as a reference interval or the normal rate. That is by using the non-parametric percentile method. I think we're explaining better here. Yeah? Now, when you talk about either you are using normal method, normal distribution method, non-parametric percentile method, you have to, okay, what percentage, what interval are you using? Are you trying to look for the middle? It may not be middle. Are you looking for 90 interval percent confidence interval or 95 or 99.9, 99.99? But of course, the recommended method, the one people use most is 95%. And I didn't want to say middle because the 95% may be middle 95%. It may, that's, we are talking of two-sided. If it's middle 95%, you are talking of two-sided. At least, if you are talking of middle, that should that you exclude the first 2.5, and exclude the last 2.5, making you have excluded 5%. The middle 95% is what you are looking at the normal range. But it can be one-sided, and the one side can be left-sided. If it's left-sided, where there's only lower limit of normality and no upper limit of normality, in that some situation, you are not concerned about, maybe the attribute may not be too high. You cannot say it's too high. But what the focus is, the one that is too low. So there are some attributes like that. It may be on the higher side, it cannot be too high. But on the lower side, it can be too low. So it's left-sided. You are concerned about the low one. In that case now, you are concerned about the first 5%. Then anything, the remaining 95% is normal. While the first 5% is not normal. You remember, if it is two-sided, it's 2.5 on one side, the lower side, 2.5 on the higher side. So you are looking at the middle 95 as normal. But if it is left-sided, the first 5% is not normal, the remaining 95% is normal. If it is right-sided, where there's only an upper limit of normal and no lower limit of normality, in that case now, you are now looking at, okay, the upper 95 in the upper 5 is abnormal. The first 95% is normal. Now, estimating interval with parametric method. What I mean by parametric method now is the normal distribution method. Normal distribution method, there's an assumption that the variable, the test, follow normal distribution. So if that is the case, you can, it is believed that if you follow normal distribution, both mean mode and mean that will be the same. So when you have your mean and you have your standard deviation, so you know that what corresponds to the middle 95% in normal distribution is standard deviation 1.96 standard deviation. It's not two standard deviation. Two standard deviation correspond to 95.45%. It corresponds to middle 95.45%. That's two standard deviation. But if you're actually looking for the middle 95%, not 95.45%, it's not up to two standard deviation, it's 1.96. And that's the origin of 1.96 you see. So in the normal distribution method, it is assumed that the attribute you are mentioning follow normal distribution, in that case, all you need to know is to know the mean, know the standard deviation. So if you know the standard deviation, multiply the standard deviation by 1.96. So if you remove 1.96 standard deviation from the mean, that will say minus. Then that would be the lower, what you get is lower limit. If you now add 1.96 standard deviation to the mean, it gives you the upper limit. So that is the method for, that is the way to do the normal distribution or parametric method. Very simple. When you do your study, it's normally distributed. All you need to do, calculate the mean, then calculate the standard deviation, then multiply the standard deviation by 1.96, remove 1.96 standard deviation of the mean, had also, that's plus or minus. So when mean minus 1.96 standard deviation will give you the lower limit, while mean plus 1.96 standard deviation give you the upper limit. That's all. Now, the estimation of reference value through non-parametric percentile method. You know, I've explained somehow. What you do that you don't, it is assumed because this, when you are dealing with attribute that does not follow normal distribution, you cannot, because it will be skewed, you cannot use mean and plus or minus 1.96 standard deviation. In that case, if you arrange in ascending order, which even when you analyze with software, it will arrange it for you, the percentile. So the first 2.5 will be anything, first 2.5 will be the, at that point, 2.5 will be the lower limit. Then the other upper 2.5, which is 97.5. You know, if you remove 2.5 from 100, it's 97.5. So at 2.5, if you look at your cumulative frequency, at 2.5% and 97.5%, those values that correspond with those value, percentile are the lower and upper limit, respectively. Now, there's an example I put here. As part of effort to determine reference interval, the value of total serum protein, PCV, and alkaline phosphatase were determined for 119 neonate. This is for neonate. So the label below show the reference interval as determined by both normal distribution, Gaussian method, which is parametric method, or non-parametric percentile method. Now, let's look at it. Look at the mean for each of them. Serum protein, PCV, 5.3 alkaline phosphatase. Look at the standard deviation. Then look at the 1.96 standard deviation. If you remove the 1.96 standard deviation of each of them from the mean, it gives you the lower limit. Yeah, can you see? And if you add the 1.96 standard deviation, it gives you the upper limit. That's the Gaussian method now. The reference interval and non-parametric percentile method, 2.5 percentile and 97.5. So when I analyze it, the audition, we did that practically during the workshop we just finished, because the workshop was on the validity, reliability, and diagnosis test. So for those of you that attended, we're able to run them and determine the value to see the value. Look at the total serum protein. The lower limit as defined by the normal distribution method is 4.6, upper limit 7.7. Why the non-parametric method is 5 to 8? It's quite close. 4.6 is approximately 5. And 7.7 is approximately 8. So you can see that they are very close. Why for the PCV, look at it. The lower limit for Gaussian method is 35.9, which approximately 36. Upper limit is 57.5, approximately 58. But this one is 38 to 59. It's a little bit better, it's close also. But look at alkaline phosphatase. The lower limit for Gaussian method is 15. Upper limit is 90.9, which is 91 approximately. But here, for the non-parametric method, is 24.98. So you see that you saw different here. So the logic here is that in interpreting this, it may appear if you, because we try also during the workshop to look at the distribution. It was discovered that the alkaline phosphatase is the most skewed. Is not normally distributed. No, something may be normally distributed naturally, but in the data set, it may not be normally distributed. So the alkaline phosphatase was not normally distributed in the data phosphatase. I think the one that was most normally distributed is serum protein, total serum protein. So you see that when a particular variable is normally distributed, the value you get from both methods are almost the same. But if it is skewed, you have different value. Now, the logic here is if it is skewed, that shows that you cannot use normal distribution method. You can now use the non-parametric method. If it's normally distributed, the result of the normal distribution method and the non-parametric are the same. And that was why the International Federation for Clinical Chemistry and laboratory medicine now recommend the non-parametric percentile method. So it's very simple, because if the attribute, the variable, the test result is not normally distributed, the non-parametric percentile method is the best, it's better. If it's normally distributed, both of them have the same value. They will give you the same thing. So in that case, it makes sense to use the non-parametric percentile method. And that is why it is the recommended method internationally. Now, that is, we have talked about reference interval now. Let's quickly now talk about criterion validity of diagnostic tests. If you have your question, you can start shouting the question so that when we finish the discussion, we can attend to the question. Let's quickly look at criterion validity of diagnostic tests. For every diagnostic procedure, there is a set of fundamental questions that should be asked. No, if the disease is present, because for every diagnostic procedure, as clinician, or even the laboratory physician, or even the laboratory scientist, what they are interested in, they are looking for a test that will be able to capture. If people have the disease, they can say this test is able to tell them that these are the people that have the disease. Then these are the people that don't have the disease. They want the test that will tell them that the people that have the disease have the disease. And the people that don't have the disease don't have it. That's what every clinician and laboratory physician or laboratory scientist look for. But if the disease is present, what is the probability that the test result will be positive? Because the disease may be there, and the test results may be the message the person does not have it. And disease may not be there. The test is on message the person have it. So now I think before I talk much about that, it's good to just talk about this next slide. In trying to find out, to know the validity of a test, you must have a gold standard. For example, if somebody wants to know the validity of pap smear, there must be a gold standard, which is usually a biopsy. Because there must be something that will tell you that categorically, these are the people that have the disease, these are the people that don't have it. To now see the judgment of it, because the test also will tell you that these are people that have it, these are people that don't have it, but you are not sure if, because you know that there are some people that have it, the test will not detect. You say they don't have it. Some people have it, say will not detect. Some people don't have it, the test will say they have it. Of course, there will be the people that they have it, the test pick them. People don't have it, the test will say they don't have it. So in that case, you want to know how true is the test, there must be a gold standard. And most of the time, the gold standard will give the near perfect result. It's not necessarily that the gold standard actually knows everything, but that is the standard. But in some occasion, you know, through biopsy, you are able to establish it. But sometimes until somebody dies, you don't even know the cause of death or the disease. Until the pathologist open up and now examine the tissue. So that is why look as if the pathologist have the last say. Even sometimes also, the pathologist may not even be able to tell you the words really kill the person. But they can tell you, these are the findings we see, those are the things we found. But you may not be able to tell which one actually even kill the person. But you can have many things, but it's still the gold standard. But there are some situations that when we are talking about psychometry instrument, you cannot actually, the only thing that the gold standard may be a particular instrument that have been valued well, that have been used for long, people believe. So you, with experience of the professional, they believe that it's gold standard enough. So you now have a new one you want to validate. So you now compare the result with that of the gold standard. Now, sometimes in the gold standard may be risky. And that is why people are looking for, but you cannot be doing biopsy for everything. If there is a test that is not, you don't need to go and take tissue, you can actually do it and you get the diagnosis to now know what to do. Because what to do, maybe you do surgery. But if, there's a test that can help you know without doing any invasive procedure before you diagnose. So you want to know how good it is. So most of the time, when you want to validate the test, you still have to use the gold standard, like a biopsy, like some risky procedure to do the gold standard. But after you have established the fact that this test is good, you can replace the gold standard. Then you cannot be doing it for people. Then forgetting about the so called gold standard. Now, was back to what I was saying before. So we already know that when you are validating an instrument, a test now, laboratory test, diagnostic test now, that will be a gold standard. So if you, whosoever the gold standard say has the disease. Whosoever the gold standard say doesn't have the disease, does not have the disease. But there are some situations where you may not even have one. What you do is that you only select, you want to validate, like for example now, the blood sugar now, you want to blood sugar for the diagnosis of diabetes. You may gather people that have been established that they have diabetes based on many things. They have the complication, they have, maybe they have been on treatment, you know that they have diabetes. And now gather other people, sample other people that are normal, that have not been diagnosed to have diabetes. So you may not use that one as the gold standard. So you have diabetic, you know them. There are some diabetic among your study, and there are people that are not diabetic. So you now do the test, do their blood sugar, fasting blood sugar, to really know the best cutoff. Because you go to see someone that is not diabetic, may have somehow comparatively high blood sugar. even compare with somebody that is diabetic. So you will now do the test for them. So in that case, you don't have one gold standard, but you have already seen what serve as gold standard is the clinical judgment, the diagnosis that have been made before that this person is diabetic, this one is not diabetic. Now, if the disease is present, you want to know what that is, if this person has the disease, what is the probability of the test being positive? That is, among the people that have the disease, how many of them will share the test, say, he has the disease, positive? That would be the sensitivity of the test. If 100 people have the disease and the test say peak has only 30, that shows that the sensitivity is low. Because only when you do it for them, out of the 100 people that have the disease, only 30 have positive test results. You know, that test cannot pick that disease. And if it's something like 80, 90, I don't know, the sensitivity is high. So the sensitivity has to do with among those that have the disease, how many people the test say have the disease. Then the other one is specificity. The among people that don't have the disease, how many people, just a minute. I will call you back, I'm in election. So among those people that don't have the disease, how many the test will say they don't have the disease? That is specificity. So what is defining who has the disease, who doesn't have the disease, is the gold standard you have set. Now, you are trying to see, okay, among these people, how many the tests say they don't have? If a test, you pick people that about 100 people don't have the disease, the test say about 60 have it. You know that it's not specific. It's telling you that 40 people don't have it. It's not specific. But if you are having maybe out of 100 people that don't have the disease, the test, about 90 of them, 80 of them don't have it. That, you know that it's very specific. It's able to pick the other people that say they have it. You know, at least it's able to pick majority of people that don't have it and say they don't have it. So that is specificity. If the test is not there, if the result, if the disease is not there, will the test be negative? That's specificity. If the test result is positive, so we have talked about sensitivity and specificity. Now we have what we call negative predictive value. If, you know, if you look at it now, talking about sensitivity and specificity, you are looking at the test, you are looking at the gold standard first to see, among the people that has the gold standard say they have the disease, how many tests say they have? Among the people that the gold standard say they don't have the disease, how many the tests say they don't have? But here, we are starting with the result of the test. Okay, among people that have positive results now, can you see how many people actually are in the camp of the people that have it? How many people actually have it by the gold standard? That is, among, if you have 100 people that have positive test results, how many of them actually have the disease? Can you see? It's a different orientation. So that is the positive predictive value. Why the negative predictive value? I mean, if you have 100 people, I say the result is negative. How many of them actually don't have the disease? Actually negative, truly negative. So that is negative predictive value. Now, we will still talk much about that because there is much to discuss about positive and negative predictive value and specificity and sensitivity. But look at distribution of test results. In the population, you're going to see when you do your test, there are two groups in the population you may not know. The two groups concerning the disease you are looking at, the two groups are the normal and the people that have the disease. But the issue is that they are not separated, they overlap. There is not written on anybody's face. They are not living in one geographical area. All of them are together. So in the population, you have two groups of population concerning a particular disease. People that are free of the disease and people that have the disease. But of course, to be sincere with you, unless if the prevalence of the disease is so high, you see that the people that have disease are lower in population than the people that don't have the disease. So that's why you see the all of them, the test results follow normal distribution. Can you see? For the people that don't have the disease, look at a bigger distribution. The people that have the disease, smaller distribution. Now, once you see there's an overlap, you know, if you are talking of the result, this graph you are seeing here, Along the horizontal is the value of the result. As you are going to the right, the value of the result is increasing. So this one, this graph is an assumption. It's assumed that is a type of result that as the value increases, the disease increases, like a diabetic. The more the blood sugar, the more likely the person will have diabetes. Unlike anemia, the lower the PCV, the more likely the person will have the diabetes anemia. So if it is something like anemia now, the disease will be on this other left side. But this is positive test, like something like diabetes, something like as the value increases, the disease is more likely to be there. In that case, if you move from zero, this vertical line, this first line is zero, that's the end, the beginning. As you, the result of the test goes up, the more likely the person will have the disease. So that is why the disease distribution is on the right side. So you expect, but there's an overlap in the sense that the people that have the disease, the result overlap with the people that don't have the disease. Now, the problem you now face as a clinician, okay, yes, as a clinician or as a laboratory scientist or as a laboratory physician, is at what level will I put? What would be the cutoff? When will I say, because this is along the result line now, when will you say the person, the cutoff that anybody have above this has the disease, anybody below this don't have the disease? That's a very big problem. You see, somebody that have blood sugar, fasting blood sugar 126 is diabetic. 125 is not diabetic. So what is the difference between 126 and 125? You just have to take decision. That was even small. That is one aspect of it. Another aspect is that even there's overlap between the people that have disease and people that don't have it. So you're going to see to some 126, the person may have 126 and blood sugar, it may not be diabetic. Whereas some people have lower than 126 is diabetic. So now if you choose, let's look, we have three scenarios here. The first scenario is the red line. Let's assume we choose this red line as the cutoff. The implication, it has its advantage and disadvantage. The advantage here is that if you choose this red line, you have captured all the, so you are telling that, you say that any value above this red line is, let's say, diabetic, for example, is diabetic. The indication, the implication is that you have captured all the people that have the disease, and say they have the disease. That's a very good one. That's the advantage. You can see everybody, because it started before the graph of the people that have the disease. But the problem is that major part of the people that are normal, so you have been classified as diabetic. Can you see? You look at this big one. Major part of it, that's the disadvantage. Then if you choose the green line, the advantage is that you have exonerated all the people that don't have the disease. Can you see the green line? All the ones that don't have the disease, you have raised, they don't have. Because anything above the green line is diabetic. Anything below is not diabetic. So that shows that all the people that are in the normal population, you have not implicated them that they have diabetes. That's the advantage. But the disadvantage is the major part of people that have the disease, you have excluded them that they don't have. Can you see? So whether you set the cutoff so low, too high or too low, you have advantage and disadvantage. So you just have to have a compromise. The compromise is you just choose something in the middle, like this dotted line. If you choose the dotted line now, you're going to see that, yes, the major proportion of people, the graph of the disease people have been captured that they have the disease. The smaller proportion that you say they don't have. Then the smaller proportion of the people that don't have the disease, you say they have. The major proportion, you say they don't have. So that's a very good compromise. So in that sense now we've already said that we have two type of population here. But by having that cutoff in the middle now, it has divided even the two population into two, making four set of people. You have the people that they don't have the disease. The test say they don't have the disease. If you use this dotted line, those are the true negative. Because the test say negative. They don't actually have the disease, true negative. But we also have people that don't have disease, but the test I said they have, that is the false positive. So true negative and false positive, they belong to the normal people. So he said that those ones that they don't have, the test say they don't have, is true negative. But there are some people, the test say they are positive, but they don't actually have it, which is false positive. Now, the other two is the people that have the disease that your test say they have, true positive. Then we now have the people that have the disease also there, your test say they don't have, that's false negative. The test say it's negative, but they actually have it, it's false negative. So true positive and false negative, they belong to the people that have the disease. Now, you move further to explain it further. Now, what we discussed the other time, true positive, false positive, all those is the same thing. As you will see on this graph, is the same thing put in the on the table. Then the similar graph is still here also to compare with it. You will see the table now. This table is 2x2 table in the sense that we have the people that have the disease and the people that don't have the disease as prescribed by your gold standard. It's conventional to put them at the vertical. But there are some people that put it horizontal, it's not the castle stone, but it makes more, it's easier to interpret, to make it a convention, to put it at the vertical, true positive, the disease present, absent. Then along the horizontal, that would be your test. So the vertical represent, the vertical axis represent your gold standard. The horizontal axis represent your test results, what you are validating. Now, positive, if you look at it now, horizontally, if you sum the total that are positive, that are positive results, A plus B. You know, by notation, A, B, C, D, when you have 2x2 table, all this total, horizontally, total, vertical, they are not part of the set. We have four sets defined by the present absence of disease and positive and negative results. So you're going to see A, B, C, D. A is the test is positive when the person has the disease. A is the same thing as the true positive. Then B is the test is positive, but the person does not have the disease. That is the false positive. Then C is the test is negative, but the person has the disease, false negative. Why D, the test is negative, the person does not have the disease, that is true negative. You will see that there are only two cells, A and D, that are true positive and true negative. So A, that's the concordant, that is positive with the disease, is positive with the test, that's A, true positive. D is negative with the disease, is negative with the test, that is true negative. These other two are discordant. Yeah, that is B, false positive. This person does not have the disease. You are implicating the person to have the disease. Why C is false negative? This person has the disease, but he tells you, say he doesn't have it. It's false negative. If you remember when I talked about the population you are dealing with, the normal and the disease people that overlap, I said something there that the normal consists of the true negative and the false positive, so they make up 100%. While the abnormal, the people that have the disease, two positive and false negative, they more make up the people that have the disease. So because of that, it now makes sense if you want to add this table together, to add it vertically, not horizontally. Because it is vertically, if you add it vertically, true positive plus false negative, that is the people that have the disease. This graph on the left, true positive, false negative. Can you see? So when you A plus B, making A plus C, A and C rather. So true positive or false negative, they are the disease people. Why? False positive and true negative are the normal people, D plus D. Now, if what is telling you is that the A plus C, true positive and false negative, they will form 100%. They add up to 100%. Why false negative and true negative, false positive and true negative add up to 100% here. So I think we'll talk about that later. But the sensitivity I talked about the other time, we already said that whenever you are looking at sensitivity, you are starting with the axis of the disease, no disease. Like for example now, this is the vertical axis, the disease present. So if you look at it, who are those people that have the disease? A plus C. So if you want to calculate the sensitivity, how many of those people that have the disease, that the test state they have is A out of A plus C. So A all over A plus C is the sensitivity. Now, if you look at specificity, you are looking at total that don't have the disease. How many the test say they don't have the disease? That is the total is B plus D, and the D of them is the D that they say they don't have. D all over B plus D, that is specificity. But when you want to look at the predictive value now, you are not using the present and absent, you are using the test result, because it's not shift horizontal. The total along the horizontal, these are the total positive result. A plus B, that is true positive and false positive. Either true or false, positive. Those are the positive results. So if how many among these A plus B, positive results, how many actually have the disease? That is A. A all over A plus B. Can you see? A all over A plus B is positive predictive value. Why if you look at you that have negative results, C plus D, either false negative and true negative, with either false or true, negative result, those are C plus D. How many don't actually have the disease, which is D? D is true negative. So D all over C plus D, that is negative predictive value. The accuracy of the test is the extent of which you have correct classification. That is, the correct classification is A, and D, that's the correct one. A is true positive and true negative. The people that have the disease, the test say they have it. The people that don't have the disease, test say they don't have it. So A plus D, can you see A plus D over the total? A plus B plus C plus D. That is the accuracy. Now, the prevalence of the disease is how many people have the disease. We already know that the people who have the disease, they are the one in this as is present, total. A plus C is the number of people that have the disease. So A plus C divided by A plus B divided by total, that is the prevalence of the disease. Now, there's something we want you to know here. You see that in calculating the sensitivity and positive predictive value is the same A you are using. The only thing that differs is the denominator. Can you see? Look at sensitivity, A all over something. Positive predictive value, A all over something. Why sensitivity is A plus the total that have the disease? Positive predictive value is A over the total that have positive test result. Can you see? So you just have to. So for sensitivity, if the positive is the people that have the disease that is denominator. Why for positive predictive value, the people that have positive result that is the denominator. There is the same cell that is serving as the numerator. The same thing with the specificity and negative predictive value. Look at it, negative predictive value. D is the, can you see, specificity. D is the numerator. But for specificity, the denominator is the number that have that don't have the disease, B plus D. While in negative predictive value is the total number that have negative result. Can you see? So it's the same numerator they have, but they have different numbers. So when you are talking of specificity and sensitivity, you are looking at your person have the disease or not, according to the gold standard first, before you now say how many are positive results, how many are negative results. But when you are talking of positive predictive value or negative predictive value, you are talking of the positive result or negative result from them, how many of them actually have the disease according to the gold standard, or how many don't have it according to the gold standard. Now, if you move further, this one is very, very, this slide is very, very important. We want to try to see the effect of the prevalence on the predictive value of test. Now, I want to tell you something about the predictive value before I say that. The predictive value, you have already said that the sensitivity, specificity is your interest as clinician. is your interest. What you are interested in, you want to be sure this result, is he able to pick those people that have the disease and say they have it? Is he able to pick those people that don't have disease and say they don't have it? So you are talking about specificity and sensitivity. That's your own edit. But for your patient, they are more, even though they don't know the meaning of negative predictive value or positive predictive value, but indirectly they know their interest is the positive predictive value and negative predictive value. Because when somebody comes with positive result, you want to know, from your experience, doctor, if somebody has this type of positive result, how many times is it true that the person has the disease? He'll be asking you. He's trying to deny. Is he actually that have this disease? It's just like somebody, a relative of yours, go to do HIV. He will wait for you, even when you are, say, I'm busy, I will wait. After you have spent all your time, say, doctor, I've collected the result too. He said, it's positive. You now ask you, doesn't mean I have HIV. That's what the question will ask you. Because they are looking at the test result. That's what you have given them. Among those people that have positive test results, how many of them actually have the disease? Among those people that have negative results, how many of them don't actually have the disease? So if somebody that received negative results, does it mean that I don't have it? I don't have diabetes? I don't have HIV? So they are more interested. So you say that you are going to say something. You will the sensitivity and specificity behave differ from the way positive and negative predictive value behave when the prevalence of disease vary in the population. We have three scenarios here, scenarios. The three scenarios have different prevalence of the disease. Look at it. The first scenario, you see people that have, 100 people have the disease, 100 people don't have the disease. 70 people have positive result, 130 people have negative result. The prevalence of the disease is 100 over 200. And you say 100 over 200, which is 50%. The sensitivity is 68 over 100, which is 68%. Specificity is 98 over 100, which is 98%. The positive predictive value is 68 over 70, which is 97.1%, while negative predictive value is 98 over 130, which is 75.4%. Now, the second scenario B, we have 100 people with the disease, 1,000 people don't have, the total is 1,100. So when you look at the prevalence, is 100 over 1,100, which is 9%. Remember the first one, the prevalence was 50%, 9%. But look at the sensitivity, 68 over 88, 68%. 68 over 100, sorry. Sensitivity 68 over 100, 68%. Then specificity is 980 over 1,000, which is still 98%. Then look at positive predictive value, 68 over 88, 77.3. Negative predictive value, 980 over 1,012, which is 96.8. The last scenario, the 100 people have the disease, 10,000 don't have. The total is 10,100. So the prevalence is 100 over 10,100 is 1%. Can you see the first one, the prevalence is 50, the second one is 9, this one is 1. So it shows you that the prevalence of disease is decreasing. Now, but look at the sensitivity, 68 over 100, 68%. Specificity, 9,800 over 10,000, 98%. Positive predictive value is 60 over 268, which is 25.4%. And negative predictive value, 9,800 over 9,832, 99.7%. You will see something. As the prevalence of the disease increases across these three scenarios, the sensitivity and specificity remain constant. It didn't change. They remain the same. You can see sensitivity remains 68 for the three of them, 68%, and specificity remains 98% for all the three scenarios. Then you look at the positive predictive value. Where the prevalence is higher, the positive predictive value is 97.1. When the prevalence go down small, the positive predictive value will go down to 77.3. When the prevalence reduces further, the the positive predictive value reduced to 25.4. Then you look at the negative predictive value. When the prevalence was high, the negative predictive value in 75.4. When the prevalence reduces more, the negative predictive value jack up to 96.8. Now when the prevalence reduces more, the negative predictive value jack up more to 99.7. You will see that as the prevalence of the of disease decreases, the positive predictive value decreases, but the negative predictive value increases. But the prevalence has nothing to do with sensitivity and specificity, because the sensitivity and specificity of a particular test is irrespective of the prevalence of the disease. It is the same everywhere. For example, in Nigeria, actually, your illustration, you know, some states persistently. There are some states that have low prevalence of HIV, like Osun State persistently have the lowest prevalence of HIV, while on different occasions, you have maybe Benue, Cross River, Port Harcourt have highest prevalence of HIV. Now, what it says that go to any state in Nigeria, if you use a particular method, irrespective of the prevalence of HIV, the sensitivity and specificity of that test remain the same. It will not change. But the predictive value will change. What it means is that if somebody comes with positive result in the Osun State, you say, I don't to do HIV, now come to you. Because you know that the prevalence of HIV is very low in that place, the probability that this person will have HIV is low also. Even though he has positive result, it's not likely to have the HIV, the possibility of the person having HIV is low. But if you go to a place where the prevalence is higher, go to that positive result. Where the prevalence is higher, the possibility that that person has this disease is higher. So that is why they say that if the prevalence of the disease is very low, even a highly sensitive test will have low predictive value. Even though the test is highly sensitive, if you go to where the prevalence is low, the positive result does not mean that the person have the disease. That's what he's telling you. Positive result does not mean that the person have disease. It's the same thing. If you are in a place where the prevalence is very high, negative result does not mean that the person does not have the disease. That is it. If the prevalence is high in a place, they say, okay, I've done the test, so it's negative. It doesn't mean no. In me, the possibility that the person is negative is very low, because the prevalence is high there. That is what is what it means. So you can see the sensitivity and specificity yield consistent results irrespective of the prevalence in all the population of a particular test, while the prevalence and the positive and negative predictive value vary with the prevalence of. Can you see now? So when your patient comes to you with result, if he says it's positive, it's negative, interpreting it depends on your knowledge of the prevalence of the disease. For you to emphatically say that, oh, you don't have the test, I say you are negative, it is negative. You know, your interpretation depends on the prevalence of the disease. So this is a graph showing this relationship. I just explained the You see, the positive predictive value vary with the prevalence of the disease. If the prevalence is increasing, the positive predictive value will increase. If the prevalence is decreasing, it will decrease also. So the relationship between them is like, if you talk about correlation, it's positive correlation, because they go together, or direct proportion in mathematics. Direct proportion, it's not inverse proportion, it's direct proportion. Is the negative predictive value that has inverse proportion with the prevalence of diseases? If it is not, just a minute. The negative predictive value is the one that inverse proportion to the prevalence of the disease, because as the prevalence increases, the predictive value decreases, and the prevalence decreases, the negative predictive value increases. Now, how do we now determine the cutoff? How do you actually know, like blood sugar, how will you know is the right cutoff? Now, we have already said before that true positive and false negative, they add up to 100, while false positive and true negative add up to 100. So if you look at it, the sensitivity is the true positive, because if you look at the sensitivity of the disease, that is true A, which is the TP over A plus C, the sensitivity, true positive. Positive. Why sensitivity, specificity is the true negative, that is D all over B plus D. Now, the implication of that is that these true positive and false negative, we have already said, they add up to one, because they belong to the population of people that have the disease. Forget that the result is one is true positive, one is false negative, but both of them have the disease. The true positive means that the person that have the disease and the test day they have it, while false negative, the person that have the disease, the test day doesn't have it. It belongs to the same generation of the disease people. While false negative, and false positive and true negative, they belong to the same, the normal set of it. So if you want to write it now, you can say that sensitivity plus false negative equal one, or sensitivity is one minus false negative. The same thing you can say, or false negative is one minus sensitivity. Specificity plus, which is true negative, plus false positive, they are equal to one. So you can as well say specificity is one minus false positive rate, while false positive negative rate is one minus specificity. Now, you will see, you can use a mnemonic, sensitivity negative. Just 1 minute. Sorry, I'm back. NEPA. I'm back. NEPA is behaving here. Okay, now let's quickly tidy it up. Now, you will see that one thing is that this, even though we have said that specificity and sensitivity, it don't vary with prevalence of disease, but when you set your cutoff, it affects your sensitivity and specificity. We have demonstrated it before. You know, when we say we shake from between using red line, green line, or the dotted line as cutoff. If you try, if it is a positive test, that is a test that as the value increases, the person is more likely to have the disease. As you increase your cutoff, that is, you increase your cutoff, you lower the sensitivity. Because you are going to, when you increase it, there are a lot of people that have it, you will not pick. But if you decrease the cutoff, you increase the sensitivity. But anytime you decrease the cutoff, you increase sensitivity, you reduce the specificity. If you increase the cutoff, you reduce the sensitivity, you increase the specificity. So they are in opposite direction. So if you try to increase your sensitivity, you definitely decrease your specificity, vice versa. Now, what I want to, there's something that's very, very important here. I want to do. Now, if we have agreed that these four scenarios are the possible scenario, two positive, false negative, true negative, how do we actually know the best cutoff? The best cutoff for us, because we know that as you change the cutoff, all these things, they change. It's like tuning a radio station. Changing the cutoff now, moving the slide, it's like you are tuning. You know, when you are tuning, you are trying to get signal. You get to a place where you hear signal and the noise reduce. Where your signal is maximum, and your noise is minimum is the best tune. Because you cannot completely reduce, eliminate noise. If sometimes when you get more noise, more signal, is loud, the noise is loud also. You now turn back onto the way you get the best signal for the smallest noise. And they use this thing in telecommunication. So they come with a concept called receivers operating characteristic call. It's later the machine and pick it up. They use it during the Second World War, trying to get signal. So through radar, when they mount the radar, they now begin to tune until they get the best, highest signal and lowest noise. That higher signal, so if they divide the signal by noise, if the signal is maximum, which is the numerator, and the noise is minimum, which is the denominator, it gives the highest value. So now if we are to ask you now, here, if I'm to ask you, which one corresponds with signal among these four? The signal is the true positive, because that's what you're looking for. Those people that have the disease and the test say they have it, that's the signal. And the noise is false positive, because false positive is the person that say, ah, you have the disease, and the person doesn't have it. It's a noise. So true, the signal is true positive, and the noise is false positive. And we know that the signal is our sensitivity, true positive. That false positive, which is the noise, is 1 minus specificity. So if you try to divide the signal, which is the sensitivity, true positive, divided by the false positive, which is 1 minus specificity, if the value that gives us the highest, that particular mathematics is what we call likelihood ratio. Likelihood ratio is sensitivity, signal, over 1 minus specificity, which is the noise. So the value of that likelihood ratio, that the highest, that is when the signal is the maximum and the noise is minimal, that would be the best cutoff, the cutoff that gives us. And you can plot it in a graph. So you is a plotting in a graph, you're just creating a visual form of it for you to see. So that shows that if you vary your cutoff, you can vary your cutoff many times. For each cutoff, calculate the sensitivity and specificity, and do your specificity over 1 minus specificity. Sensitivity over 1 minus specificity, which is likelihood ratio. When you do it, the cutoff that gives you the highest of that likelihood ratio will be the best cutoff. If the cutoff that's able to discriminate, tell you that, okay, say that the people that have, how many times, it tell you that the people that have it more than when it tells you that the people that don't have it. That is the likelihood ratio. So if you plot in the graph, you call it receivers operating characteristic. The best cutoff will be the most right, leftmost and uppermost, the most leftmost and uppermost part of the graph. And it will show you in the graph. If you look at the sensitivity, the vertical, the 1 minus specificity, 1 minus specificity, which is the noise, is the horizontal. When you plot it, if the diagonal, the graph is along the diagonal, it's telling you that it's 50-50. If you remember when something, the equilateral triangle, one both sides are equal. Because if you look at the scale here, 1:1. Which is 100%. The scale along here is 1 also. So the diagonal is, the angle is 45 degrees. So it means that both numerator and denominator is the same. Sensitivity is the same thing as 1 minus specificity. So it's like gambling. You want to know how many. So it will give you 1. It's telling you that if you, the likelihood ratio will be 1. It's like 50-50 if the graph is along the diagonal. But the more the graph is above the diagonal, the better it is. If the graph is close to that one, that corner, that's the best. So the area under the graph, the more the graph is going up, the more the area under the graph, because the total area is 1. If you look at 1 times 1, is 1 now. The side, the vertical side is 1. The total is 1. The highest is 1. Here is the highest 1. 1 times 1, 1. The area is 1. So the area is 1, which is 100%. The more the graph go to the left corner, the more, the better. demand the discriminating power of your test. It's able to tell you, separate the people that have the disease from those that don't have it. And the better your likelihood ratios will be, the cut off, the better it will discriminate for you. So I think we stop here. And last question. So we have talked. So I didn't see any chat. So it means that it's very simple. Any question? So you can ask your question without chat then. You can chat also, you can ask it. Thank you. Yes, okay, thank you. Always thank you, Gilo. Thank you. Any question? So it means that it's well understood. But when you don't have questions like that, it means that it's well understood. Any question? Okay, if there's no question, that would be great. Let me stop the...